something that, again, exists in most editing softwares. If I come up here to the effect, there's a little button that says stabilization. I can just click this, check that box, and what's going to do is it's going to begin to analyze this clip and eliminate the shakiness of it. So if I go ahead and play it.
Upcoming Star Wars media. Are you a fan of The Mandalorian? John Favreau?
So it takes a little while for the stabilization to come into effect, because it has to analyze the clip and apply the effect. But usually I'll go and edit other parts of the video while it's working on that. So this is a good time for us to drag in our background music. I'm going to bring the background music in. I'm going to line it up right at the beginning, and I'm going to cut it where my video ends. So let's take a listen.
Hello, Star Wars fans, and may the Force be with you. Today we're bringing you the latest news on upcoming Star Wars media. Are you a fan of The Mandalorian? John Favreau just released some new updates on Season 2. Also, how is new Disney CEO Bob Chapek's role going to affect Kathleen Kennedy and the future of Star Wars? Stay tuned for the answer to these questions and more.
Background music actually doesn't sound bad this time. Mm-hmm. We were editing this video before, and the background music was too loud. I'm actually going to turn it down just a skosh, just a little bit. But now, wouldn't you say that looks pretty professional?
Mm-hmm.
Now all of you know how to make a professional-looking YouTube video.
Mm-hmm.
It's not too hard.
The iMovie on the iPhone, because the iPhone has iMovie app.
Mm-hmm. That's
the iMovie on the iPhone, I think it's totally different as I saw on here.
Yes.
Yeah, those one is really hard to use.
So the version of iMovie that is available on the iPhone is different from this software because it has to be interactive with a touchscreen instead of a keyboard.
Mm-hmm.
So instead of, you know, me pressing a button to split the clip, I'm, you know, having tap and slide and, you know, do all sorts of things.
Mm-hmm.
So it's a little bit different. I used to use it very frequently when I was starting out doing YouTube videos 8 years ago. I honestly haven't used the app version in a while, so I really can't point out too many of the differences. But I do know that for a while it was one of the best mobile platform-based editing software is available. So I don't know if that has changed in the last couple of years, because I don't use my phone to edit very often.
Mm-hmm.
But if you do have an iPhone, I would not say anything against using your iPhone to edit your videos. Now the one thing that is going to be really tricky is going to be syncing your audio that you recorded with your microphone. If you're using the app, it's going to be very hard to do that on your phone because of the way that the timeline is set up and the way that you're interacting with it. If you're on the computer, it's easier to do. But again, if you're just getting started out and all you have for your recording to start off with your videos is your phone, and you can shoot and edit on your phone, why not? That's a great place to start.
I know there's another popular the editing software.
Mm-hmm.
Is called Vue.
Okay.
And I noticed if I upload with Vue to YouTube and the quality, the resolution significantly dropped. I don't know why.
So there's a couple of reasons for that. I'm going to try not to get too technical. But the first reason is, when you upload your video to YouTube, YouTube is going to actually change the format of your video. It's going to change the resolution of your video. It's going to do a lot of things to your video to make sure that people can watch your video even if they have very low bandwidth. Have you ever, you know, been watching your video somewhere on YouTube and it was in HD? And then you walk into a building and now you're watching it in low resolution because it's not getting the same amount of data through the internet as it was before. So sometimes when you watch a video, and for me, I like to watch my video as soon as I upload it. The version of the video that YouTube puts online first is the lowest resolution possible. So it's going to look different. Now, sometimes when a video is a lower resolution, it causes the color to look different. So that might be part of the problem. There's also a thing called color space, which is kind of a whole software algorithm that processes the way we perceive color in a video. Now, the software that you're using might use one type of color space to edit that video, but the internet might use a different type of color space. So there's a type of color space and that the internet uses for all of its video. And depending on what editing software you're using, you might be using one of 10 different color spaces. So there's a couple of reasons why your color might look a little different once it goes onto YouTube. It also might be the monitor that you're using. And this has happened to me a few times where I was editing using my monitor at home, and it was just calibrated differently so that when I uploaded my video to YouTube and I watched it on my TV or I watched it on my phone, it looked different than it did on my monitor. So those are all different factors of why it might have looked different. And unfortunately, without seeing your setup for myself, I wouldn't really be able to answer that question accurately. Those are just three things that I can, those are three things that I've experienced that might be what you experienced. So, an excellent question. Any other questions about editing so far?
Oh, wait, my question is not editing. My question is, what kind of lens do you use?
Okay. The type of lens I use is going to depend on the type of shoot that I'm doing. For this camera, the lens that I have is actually a standard Sony 18 to 105 millimeter lens. The reason I got that lens was because the one I wanted was on back order, and I could get that one today. Well, I mean, not today, last year when I bought the camera.
It's new, right?
It's relatively new. So I bought this camera almost a year ago for one of the projects that my company does on a regular basis. I wanted to have a designated camera just for that. On the other hand, some of the videos that I shoot for my clients, if I'm shooting more professional-looking interviews, I might, instead of using this zoom lens, I might use a prime lens, which is a lens that can't zoom. The advantage to that is that is going to look a lot better. It's going to have much better image quality. The depth of field, which is what we talked about earlier, how you're in focus and the background is blurry, that's going to look a whole lot better with a prime lens. The downside to a prime lens is A, you can't zoom, and B, they're usually a little bit more expensive than the zoom lenses because they're using higher quality materials to build them. So when you're looking for lenses, keep in mind if you want a zoom lens or a prime lens. It's going to be something that you can use in your search to help you find the lens that you want.
Question regarding editing. Mm-hmm. Let's say if I want to shoot a yoga video.
Okay.
And I have two cameras from different angles.
Sure.
When you're editing them together, there are two sets of files. Like when you blend them, is the same technique using here?
Yes. So using that same clap your hands to sync it, that works with multiple cameras as well as it does with a separate audio track. So it's going to work the same way. You're just going to line them up and look for that clap.
If you take a video by yourself, so how can you make sure you're focusing on yourself? Because if you put the camera over there, you cannot see it. So you don't know if the camera focuses on you or focuses on some other stuff.
That is an excellent question, and I'm glad that you brought that up. Because that is something that has been an issue for me a was first starting out. It was very hard for me to make sure that my camera was in focus. And sometimes my camera would focus on something behind me, or I would just look blurry the entire time that the video was playing, and then I'd have to go and shoot it again. And so to save yourself the hassle of having to shoot your video again, what kind of camera are you using?
I'm using Canon 5D.
Okay,
yeah.
And are you using the autofocus on it?
Yeah, I use for yeah.
Okay, so typically.
But it's kind of hard for me to get focus on myself.
Yeah. So it's tricky. So when you're using a DSLR, you can switch from autofocus to manual focus. When you're using your phone, pretty much it's always going to be autofocus. But if you have the ability to shoot in manual focus, it's better because then your focus isn't going to change while you're talking. Your focus is going to stay the same for the whole video. But it's harder to focus on yourself because you can't stand in front of the camera and behind the camera at the same time. So what I learned to do a long time ago is just to find something that's as high, as tall as I am, whether that's a coat rack or a ladder or a mic stand, anything that you might have laying around your house that's tall like you are, the same height that you are, and I'd put that thing where I'm going to be in the frame. If I'm sitting, maybe there's a stuffed animal or a pillow in the house that I can put in the chair that'll be about the same size that I am. Or if I'm standing, I'll use that, a coat rack or a ladder or something that's tall. And I'll put that in the frame in the exact place where I'm going to stand, and I'll mark that place with a piece of tape so I know to stand there. And then I'll go behind the camera and adjust my focus so that the thing that is in my place will be in focus. Then I'll go and move that thing and stand there. I'll take a test shot to make sure I look good, and if I look good, I'll record. Takes a little bit longer, but then I know that the focus is not going to change in the middle of my video.
How about for the yoga video, though? She's moving around.
Right.
So you can't really just have a straight up focus. You have to do auto.
Exactly. And that's a good point to bring up, too. And what kind of camera are you using for your yoga video?
Just mirrorless Sony.
Okay. You're using the same camera I use. Okay, so what I would recommend, and I didn't want to talk about exposure too much today. That's a huge topic in videography, and we could spend all day talking about that. But I'm just going to give you this little tip. Shoot with your aperture closed at maybe 6 or 7. And what that's going to do is you're going to have to turn your ISO up more to make it brighter. Because when you close your aperture that much, it's going to look really dark. But what that's going to do is that's going to give you more room to move around so that you won't get out of focus.
I think I probably have a little tip for this because I have Sony too. You can simply download an app called Image Editing or something. And then to connect with this one, and you can see yourself on here. And then you click yourself, you autofocus.
Oh.
And then you click start, and then it's starting recording. This is what I'm using.
That's actually a great point, too, that I forgot about. you should teach the class.
No,
and I'm glad you brought that up. Because one of the great things about Sony cameras is how easy they are to connect to your devices. So just with my laptop, my phone, my iPad, there's always a Sony app that I can download that'll allow me to look at and control my camera even if I'm not standing behind it. Now, Canons and Nikons and other cameras also have similar features, but Sony's by far works the best. So it's actually